Welcome to Now Church. We are about to begin. Please take this opportunity to pull out your smartphone so you can like, share, and check in on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag NowChurch. Thank you, and enjoy today's service.
This is Anybody want freedom to fill the room today? I don't have a choir up here this morning, so you gotta be the choir. Every time we gather, we are mindful that you're faithful to us. So all over this building, if you could throw up those hands and just say, God, you are good, and I am grateful. One more time, tell them, Jesus, you are good, and I am grateful. All right, before we put lyrics up, come on, lift your voices, lift your voices. You are good, you are good, you are good, yeah. So good, Jesus, you are, yeah. Good God, faithful are you, Lord, yeah, yeah. This morning, Lord, yeah, let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, He is my son. You know what, right? Say, let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, He. Now you know this real strong. Sing it out, say, you are, come on, church. You are, yeah. Good declaration, say, you are good, yeah, good. Oh, 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 you are good, yeah. Oh, say, let me.
God, how faithful you are,
you are good.
today. You're faithful in every situation. You're faithful through every storm, God, through every trial. He's not leaving you or forsaking you today. So taking a moment, because there's somebody in this room who needs to hear the faithfulness of our God. He is good and his mercy endures. He is good and his faithfulness endures from generation to generation. He is good, he is good. Yes, you are, Lord. And I believe that you're never gonna, you're never gonna be down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. I can see with eyes of faith that you're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. Oh, oh, oh. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. Have a firm foundation. Lift your worship now, yeah. You're never gonna let me down. Sing it with a tune. Sing it, rains came. last time, say, last time, church, you sing it by yourself. You sound so good. Say, rain. Thank you, Jesus.
You know, it is not about like life always being perfect, but it's something of a strong rock of Jesus that you build your life on. One of the greatest promises we have is not that everything would go well, but that when we go through things, there's something that's greater inside of us that overcomes the world. Jesus. And this is the reality of it. When the tests of life come, that you go in and you find that place of that rock solid place where eternity you're covered, but right now God and His grace and His strength can flow through you and turn a tough situation around to be an incredible testimony. He loves flipping the script and just absolutely embarrassing the enemy. Come on, that's what happens. That's the beauty of a testimony, where you're able to come out and you're able to be a blessing to many more people by saying, look what God did, though. Look what, no, it wasn't like what happened. Look what God did, though, through it all, right? And so we're just so thankful about that. I just want to encourage you. We're going to pray about a few things. We're going to just believe God about a few things, but I want this to encourage you again. And just believe God. You've got more than you need in Christ. Everything you need to get through this. You got everything you need. You don't have to wait for the day that it all works out to be happy. You've got everything you need right now in Him.
Yeah.
Amen? Everything you need. Everything you need. So thank God. Here's something that's happened even this last week. We had a healing take place right now. And I just got to say, Gary right here.
Come on, man.
Right? Gary, he missed this last Easter. They were preparing to come to church, and he started to have a stroke, and it was a really scary situation. We had several people praying for him, and he's down here worshiping today. All of his heart and might. Man, God is good. Amen. We heard from a few other members of our church that are believing God. They were dealing with sickness, and we're praying for them as well, too. They're watching us right now live stream. We love you. We're believing God for complete healing. And one of the things that happened this last week we wanted to cover as well, too, stuff that was happening in our community. We were focused on Easter and all of our guests and everything, but there were some things we wanted to pray for this week. And if you've been watching the news, there were some different violent crimes that were taking place that were all in our community related to youth. And we love this generation, our young generation. And we want to pray for them, and we want to pray for the churches in our area that we would have divine solutions and words that reach our generation. Because it says, without a vision, people perish. Without a vision, people cast off restraint. Without a vision, a youthful young generation will be lost. They need a vision from heaven. So let's just pray right now over this and over our nation and over our city. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you can turn these things completely around. And what the enemy has written as a script, you're flipping it in Jesus' name. Father, we pray that you would just continue to cut him off at the pass. Anything that he meant for evil, Lord, we pray that you turn it for good. And Lord, we pray right now in Jesus' name for all those that were dealing with sickness. We believe that we call an end to it now in the name of Jesus. Right now, pray for healing right now. We pray for restoration right now. We pray for bodies being made whole right now in the name of Jesus, according to what you have done and your work, your power inside of us. Lord, we thank you for your promises of bringing vision to our youth. Lord, we pray for vision in our youth, Lord, that you capture their hearts. Lord, that if they've gone so far, run so far in any different direction, that they would come to an end and realize that it is pointless, that it is purposeless. And Father, we believe you that you would just breathe life into our youth in this community. Lord, give our churches divine wisdom and strategies. Lord, give us strategies to reach this generation, words to reach this generation. In Jesus' name, and we pray, Lord, for a mighty move of God, your spirit among the young, Lord. Let them lead this in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your strength and power in this time. And thank you that you're a God that turns it around. We give you praise. Amen. Come on. Let's give him praise. Awesome. All right. Hey, we're so glad that you're here at Now Church, and this is your moment. You know, we want to make sure that we have greeted you, but we want to make sure that you greet each other as well, too. I want you to turn, you know, something I told the Now crew this morning. I encouraged them with a simple thought. You know, the word says that God calls you by your name, right? Listen, God calls you by your name. He could have said, okay, all y'all, he's Southern, all y'all, I love all y'all. But God says he calls you by your name. So I think as people of God, men and women of God, fellow believers and fellow family members, I want you to turn around. If you don't know their name, it's cool. It's okay. I get that too. But just make sure you turn around and you get to know a few different people around you by their name. Say hello and call them by their name or find out what their name is. Go for it now. Go, go, go. I love the buzz. Hey, this is awesome. We got some great stuff to celebrate with you. Man, Easter was incredible here last week. Come on, that was fantastic. You all enjoyed this, and we've got some pictures to share with you in the know right now and some things that have taken place. And first off, we had some incredible worship this last week. Yeah, if you didn't get a chance to see this, it is worth watching again. We had this on Facebook, but the worship was incredible. Yeah, see that? All the choir up here. Didn't you enjoy everyone up here? That was cool. They've been working on that and getting prepared for it. So it was just really good, a great time to celebrate, incredible atmosphere, and so many people in here. And of course, there was an incredible message, Pastor Richard. That was an amazing message last week. I mean, if somehow you missed last week, again, that is absolutely worth hearing. It was just a whole fresh perspective about, you know, just about what Jesus has done and all that relationship means, you know, just as it said, to die for. It was so good. And of course, there's donuts. You know, donuts are always good, not necessarily to die for, but they're still good. So it was really fantastic. And then, of course, with our children's ministry, they had so much fun back there. They had an incredible time back there. And they want to let you know, as far as the attendance that we had of people coming and with children coming, children, that was some of the biggest crowds we had for children's ministry since the time of lockdowns. So that's amazing. Come on. So good. So good. That was even in the midst of construction and all of this stuff, and we still had so many great people coming here. So we're just celebrating, and we're believing God. You know, one of the biggest things that happened to you, we want to celebrate, so many people responding here to salvation, that preached message, and there are so many that respond to both services. So we're going to be praying and believe. I ask you to pray and believe for them, just as Paul said, that Christ would be formed in them. That it wouldn't just be a moment or just an event, but it'd be a lifetime experience, right? A relationship. So please be praying with us, because that's an incredible time. Want to welcome all of you. Thank you for coming to Now Church. If this is your first time, make sure you go by our welcome center out there. You'll see that on your way out to the parking lot and that covered shelter area. You want to go by there. We have some gifts for you. We always want to bless you and thank you for coming. And if this is your first time, you've already started something. It's called a three-week challenge. Just check out Now Church 3 weeks in a row and see what God does. Why is it important? Why is it important even 3 weeks in a row? You know, it takes a little bit to start a pattern. And sometimes you need to hear something once, twice, three times, and suddenly a light bulb goes on. Ah, that's what it's all about. That's why I'm here. So hopefully that's something that takes place in that time. You may find 3 weeks turns into 2 months, 2 years, a couple decades. It happens here. It's awesome. So just do that. You don't want to miss it. Right now, I want you to welcome with me Pastor Richard up here.
Thank you. I thought Pastor Chris was going to go into the Commodores like once, twice, three times a lady. Anyway, it's great to be together. It's always unusual as a pastor, because there's so much happening on Easter Sunday every year. And typically what you don't know is the next Sunday after Easter is usually just a very light crowd and stuff like that. You powered through. You powered through. You're here. And it doesn't have to be that way. I don't know. Human nature is just very strange. But we're glad that you're here and hope it's going to be equally. In fact, we have kind of a different plan today. It's kind of different. And the people who aren't here are going to be really sorry they missed. It's just been really, really powerful. I'll tell you more about it in a minute. But I want to set up, before we get into the message, 2 weeks from today, we celebrate the 33rd anniversary of Now Church. This year it's going to be, so it's May 1st is the actual anniversary. We started on a Tuesday night in 1990 with 70 people exactly. We didn't have any idea how many people would show up. We had 70 people in the room. We thought that was a prophetic number out of Jesus sending them out two by two, the 70. So we had exactly 70, and within a few weeks, I preached it up to about 30. It was powerful. It was amazing. So we had a retro growth. But anyway, that's 70 people to hear the original vision. And here we are 33 years later, still on the original vision. Still on the original vision. Still pursuing God. And very excited. And what we do, so once a year, for those of you that are newer, we do something called Heart for the House. It's a once a year sacrificial offering in the over and above. It's something beyond tithes and offerings. It's something where we ask you the next few weeks, the next 2 weeks, to set aside something with your kids. In fact, this morning they're doing something with the children, and they're doing like a little box that they're making to prepare for their Heart for the House. And so we want you to be a part of that as well. And as individuals, as families, whatever, it's at the end of the service in 2 weeks, we have a special moment where people come up and present their offering before the Lord. We have a special time of prayer. And this is something where we're asking you to set aside your best offering, but for a purpose. And that purpose is that God would meet you at your point of faith for what you're believing for. We appreciate what you do for the church. That's great. But this is about you and God. This is about, you know, there are moments in Scripture where people set aside something as a special offering, and the Bible says that God's favor came upon that and met them at their point of faith. And so it's not hoopla, it's not hype, it's real. And so if you've been around here for years, you already know it's real. We have seen tremendous testimonies and miracles as people have trusted God with their hearts. It's about your heart for God's house. And we say around here, when you take care of God's house, God will take care of your house. Amen? Amen. So just a little setup there for what's coming. Today's message, we continue our theme, Good God. Good God. Everybody say, Good God.
Good God.
And we continue our thought today with a message I call Stronger Than You Think. Stronger Than You Think. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 40 and Isaiah chapter 63. Isaiah 40 verse 10 from the Message says this. Isaiah says, look at him. God, the master, comes in power, ready to go into action. I want you to just remember that phrase. Ready to go into action. He is going to pay back his enemies, and reward those who have loved him. Like a shepherd, he will care for his flock, gathering the lambs in his arms, hugging them as he carries them, leading the nursing ewes to good pasture. Now, I want to weave in there Isaiah 63, verse 7 from the New King James says this: I will mention the loving kindnesses of the Lord and the praises of the Lord, according to all that the Lord has bestowed on us, and the great goodness toward the house of Israel, his people, which he has bestowed on them according to his mercies, according to the multitude of his loving kindnesses. Let's pray one more time. Father, would you open the eyes of our heart? Lord, take us beyond information into revelation, that we can experience you in what you're saying right now to us as a body, as a people, as families, as couples, as individuals. And we promise you the praise, the honor, and the glory in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. I want you to know that no matter what, God is good. No matter what you're going through, I appreciate what Pastor Chris was saying earlier and how we've gone through challenging moments. You know, what you don't know is for the last 3 weeks, my wife and I have been out of our house, kind of kicked out of our house because my wife is highly allergic to mold, and we had a mold problem develop in two sections of our house, and it didn't really come to light until about 4 weeks ago. And she got like an allergy attack the night before church, and then it didn't go away until we left the house, and then she was fine. Then we went back, and she got very, very sick, and it tried to get into her lungs. So she actually woke up 3 or 4 days after this attack. We didn't know what was going on. We both have allergies, but she is highly allergic to mold. She woke up a few days after this attack, and she goes, I feel like God just dropped it in my spirit. I think we have mold. We'd had a couple of wet spots a couple of years ago where there was like a little, you know, our house is 22 years old. And so we had a couple of things where we had them repaired. We thought everything was good. And sure enough, we had experts come in. And I mean, our house was loaded with mold spores. And we've been through insurance. We've been through all this stuff. And I want you to give it up for Pastor Lindsay. He's the host with the most because he has, we haven't stayed with him every night, but we've stayed with him 3 weekends in a row. The first weekend was one night. The second weekend, last weekend was two nights. This weekend was three nights. And we're moving out today. So just so, anyway, so they did all the work. They did all the work on Thursday. We had it air tested again, and we get the test results back this Tuesday, but we are moving in by faith. So I just wanted you to know, see, sometimes what you don't realize is there, you know, in life, everybody has stuff they go through, not just believers, unbelievers. We all have stuff we go through, but God's goodness shows up in the midst of it. And it's been hard because I can't even describe to you. I didn't tell you because I didn't want you to know how discombobulated I felt. I just wanted to go through, and I don't know if anybody's ever been combobulated, but discombobulated is not a good feeling. And so anyway, I'm not a complainer. I like to tell you after. I told the prayer warriors, by the way. I got the prayer people praying, but I didn't tell you from a public in a service here for first service because God is good, and his goodness comes through even when you're going through a crap storm. Okay, it does. We go through stuff, but that's why our house is built on a firm foundation. Even if your house attacks you, you have power in Jesus' name, and God will provide as you work through that moment. And his goodness is not limited. So no matter what, God is working his best, not just his good, right? Now, we can't focus on the greatness of God's goodness without drilling down into some of the scriptural thoughts of the original languages, like Hebrew and Greek. And you don't have to be a theologian or a linguist to catch the meaning of a word I'm going to look at right now. It's an old English word, and yet there's no better word, and yet it doesn't really do the whole thing, and that's the word loving kindness. It just seems like a like it should be hyphenated, but it's not. It's one word, loving kindness. Loving kindness, God's loving kindness. Now, it sounds like loving kindness, right? And it's kind of that way, but let me give you the original understanding of this for a few minutes before we do something else. The word in Hebrew for loving kindness is the word chesed. Sorry, Dave, I didn't mean to spit in your eye there. It's H-E-S-E-D, but it's pronounced in Hebrew, chesed. You got like chutzpah, chesed, chesed. Say that with me, chesed. Okay, now cling off the back of your neck for the people behind you. Okay. Chesed, it literally means goodness, kindness, and faithfulness. But that's not all it means. The King James translates in the Strong's Concordance in the following manner. Mercy. 149 times loving kindness is translated mercy. 40 times it's translated kindness. 30 times it's translated loving kindness. And 12 times goodness. All from chesed. The problem with English alone is that it limits the full understanding. And you know, I like words, and I'm going to say it wimpifies it. It wimpifies it. It makes it, loving kindness sounds like tippy-toeing through the tulips to me. It's like, oh, he's loving kindness. Oh, he's so loving and kind. And he is, but that's not what this word means. Vine's Bible Dictionary writes this. In general, you can identify three basic meanings of chesed. And these three meanings also interact. Strength, steadfastness, and love. Strength, steadfastness, and love. Any understanding of chesed that fails to suggest all three of these inevitably loses some of the richness of the language, of what it means. Love by itself easily becomes sentimentalized, or universalized apart from the covenant. This word chesed is about covenant relationship. It is about covenant between Abraham and God that God swore to take down through the generations. Strength or steadfastness suggests only the fulfillment of a legal or similar obligation. But chesed refers primarily to the mutual and reciprocal rights and obligations between the parties of a covenant relationship, especially between Jehovah, our God, and Israel, his people, or Zion, his church. But chesed is not only a matter of obligation, it's also a matter of generosity. It is not only a matter of loyalty, but also of mercy. Chesed implies personal involvement, listen, and commitment in a relationship beyond the rule of law. So in other words, God has a covenant with us, but he doesn't just show up because he has the covenant legally. He shows up because his covenant represents his passion for you. That when you're under attack, he resents it and he goes into battle stations. That he responds to his covenant when we were attacked with mold. God went into battle stations for us, and even though it was uncomfortable walking through this past month, really, God was with us every step of the way, and we got to stay in a brand new house, almost brand new. This better than any hotel I've ever been in. Pastor Lindsay's house. And he fed us and he took care of us. God shows his loving kindness as a relational response to all those with whom he has covenant. If Jesus is your Lord, you have a covenant with the God of the universe through the blood of Jesus. And it doesn't just give you access to that relationship, but to draw on that relationship in moments of difficulty, challenge, or pain, you can call upon the name of the Lord and you will be saved. You will be delivered. You'll be set free. You'll be guided around it, and it will come out the best possible at the end. A covenant is higher than a legal contract. It's about promise. In a covenant, you make vows. You make promises, like in a wedding. When you receive Jesus, you and God exchange vows. You just didn't realize his vows to you are in his word. And how do you get that word? You go to the word, you find that word, and you pull on that word, and you say, but Father, you said, it is written. It's promised favor. Listen, his goodness, I'll put it this way. This is my translation. His goodness has muscles. His goodness, remember I said in the beginning that the scripture in Isaiah, that's chesed, when it says God is ready to go into action. He's powered to go into action for you on your behalf. That's chesed. That's his loving kindness, his tender mercy. It's not some wimpy thing. It's not some, oh, you poor thing. Let me just pat you on the head till you get through this. It's, if you're upset, God is upset. If you're under attack, God takes it personally. God said, if they're speaking against you, they're speaking against him and the apple of his eye. That's chesed. It's this relationship covenant that goes into action. It is that devoted love promised in covenant. Devoted love. Not just love like, oh, I love you. It's love like, okay, you touched my love. I'm going to bind that spirit. You're not going to be permitted to be under attack or give the devil the last word. The Abrahamic covenant, Genesis 12:2, the nutshell is, I will bless you, God says, and I'll make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. And it's basically all the families of the earth. Remember chapter 3, verse 13, from the message of this. Christ, Jesus, redeemed us from that self-defeating curse life by absorbing it completely into himself. Do you remember the scripture that says, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree? That's what happened when Jesus was nailed to the cross. He became a curse and at the same time dissolved the curse. And now because of that, the air is cleared and we can see that Abraham's blessing is present and available for non-Jews too. We are all able to receive God's life, his spirit in and with us by believing, just the way Abraham received it. That's powerful, that what Jesus did for us, we celebrated last week, we're still celebrating this week because that's what we celebrate all the time. His loving kindness is constantly and consistently being extended to us because of Jesus' sacrifice. Look at the language of the psalmist. Psalm 63, verse 3. Because your loving kindness, how good is it? It's better than life. Because your loving kindness is better than life. See, if we said your love is better than life, it sounds poetic, it sounds like a romance. But your loving kindness, your covenant, promise, and power going into action on my behalf is better than life. My lips shall praise you, thus I will bless you while I live. I'll lift up my hands in your name. Some of you newer folks, you know, Pastor Lynn says, lift your hands. And I, you know, the first time it's always uncomfortable. I see some people that came in uncomfortable and were, I'll raise a hand, you know, for a second, but I hope nobody sees me. And now they're like, yes, I just know what he's doing. I can't praise him enough. If part of my praising his lifting of my hands, I'm willing to be uncomfortable. I'm willing to look foolish the first few times because I realize it's something that's in the word that God says. I will lift up my hands in your name. Psalm 42, verse 8. The Lord will command. See, this is a language. Look at the language of this. The Lord will command his loving kindness in the daytime. That's powerful. He will command his loving kindness in the daytime when things are going well. And in the night, the psalmist said, his song shall be with me. The song of his covenant, his song of his loving kindness will be with me, a prayer to the God of my life. His loving kindness, chesed, means that God carries us as a father carries his children. You don't probably don't remember, but some of my earliest memories, my parents were always busy and always doing stuff when I was growing up. You know, the firstborn, you know, always grows up when the parents are poor, you know, let's be honest. So my parents were just always running. My dad, you know, my parents are both professional singers as well as teachers. And so they were always going to a choir practice or to do sing at a church or to sing at a concert or whatever. My dad did weddings, sang at weddings almost every Saturday for years. He would sing at funerals. He would just all over. And I just was put in the car. My earliest memories are falling asleep in the car to the old crackle of an AM radio. Some of you don't even know what that is. But anyway, I can't see hard to explain. But to the crackle of an old AM radio, I'd fall asleep in the backseat. And my dad would always carry me in, and I would wake up in the morning in my bed. And so there are moments where God the Father just simply carries you through those night seasons. And sometimes you look back at some of the pain we've all experienced and been through, and you go, how did I don't know how I made it through that. People even say, how did you get through that? That's horrendous. He carried me. Like a father carries his kids. Like a shepherd carries his lambs. He brings them back. Carries them through. Feeds, nurtures, provides sleep and rest and protection. He's a good God, a good father, and a great shepherd. Amen? Now, I want to do something really different. Haven't done this in a long time. I want to show you a little bit of little video for the rest of the time. Last Monday, I was basking in the flow and the glow of being at church for Easter, and on Monday, my dear friend, Pastor Julian Melfi from London, sent me a video that they made in his church. It was really well done. It's a couple named Mike and Jill, older couple, well, younger couple than me, but anyway. it's just powerful. They shot this kind of like we used to shoot like documentaries and things ourselves before our team got so busy doing other churches, which is another thing that's great and expands, but it's very powerful. Now here, I want to kind of set up this way. For those of you that don't watch British TV shows or have British humor like I do, you're going to have to tune your ears in, because they don't speak Americanish, they speak English. Which when I go there, they accuse me of not speaking English, but I speak Americanish. Okay? So tune your ears. And Marcel, can I get you to come and get this out of the way? And we're going to have this about 14 minutes, but you're going to love it, I promise you. And I want to encourage you, open your heart. Listen to their testimony. Listen to what God has done in all these different facets. Listen to his loving kindness.
I was born in Bermondsey, Bermondsey boy, as we called. My father died in 1969, so I was brought up by my mum. I was different. I was, as an adult, diagnosed with autism, but as a child, I was just different, and no one knew why, but I didn't play football. I couldn't read signals from other people, all that sort of thing. All of this, the fact that I was bullied, I was on a spectrum, all those things led to creating quite an angry person, and that's what I became. I was quite an angry person. We got together at 19.
You were 19 when I met you.
And you were 22 when we met. I got told off for that one. I did.
I was going home back to Trinidad because I didn't want to live here anymore. And we went in a discotheque down in Catford.
Yeah.
I left you with the knowledge that I was going to come back.
Yeah.
And I told my mum I was coming back because I'd met this person, and she completely was not happy with me. Is he a lawyer or a doctor? She said, no, he's
neither.
Not. Neither, he's a builder. They wouldn't speak to me
because of
you. I think I felt abandoned, and I think because they abandoned me, I felt that God had abandoned me.
I was still angry and crazy.
He was very angry. Amazingly angry.
I'd gone through bouts of depression. I'd been on medication. I'd been sent to for counselling. All these different things. I was still angry, I was still sad, I was still in a place I didn't want to be in my mind.
Obviously we loved each other loads, but he would shout, wouldn't you? He would shout at me and scream at me. It was part of his own illness and his own anger. I suppose instead of trying to calm it down, I just learned how to shout too. So that's what we did. We screamed at each other. It was normal.
Yeah, it was normal. She was in absolute agony. We managed to get her home, and then she spent a good year on the sofa, and Jill couldn't even get to the toilet. I stopped what I was doing because we had two young girls by then. We had Lara and Maddie.
And I think that we became very, very depressed, as in, why can't we get out of this cycle that we're in? We were in such a bad cycle that one minute I was okay, I could walk about a bit on a stick, and then next minute I was back in the wheelchair again.
Jill's always had an issue with the same three discs, L3, L4, L5, which is lumbar, the lower part of your spine. And I had the same three disc problem. I was laid up for a year. I was on more than 30 tablets a day, which are stronger than morphine. And I could hardly say someone's name. It was, I was so full of all this medication. But if I didn't, the pain was just excruciating.
I'd speak to my aunts, then my Auntie Marlene and Auntie Claudia. And every time I spoke to Auntie Marlene, she would say, "We're praying for you. It'll all be okay. We're praying for you." And when she first used to say that, I used to think, well, I don't know. I don't even know if you should be praying, but carry on. I used to have the phone, didn't I? And I used to look at you and I used to go,
like this.
She's gonna pray for us.
Like that.
It was like that. How awful.
And when we think back, how awful.
I know. We believed that he existed. That was it.
I never blamed God once for anything. I just felt he didn't show up there. And then we'd gone to breakfast one day.
Yeah.
I put some cereal in a bowl. I put my spoon in the bowl, and as I lifted it out of the bowl to get it to my mouth, the whole thing went flying across the harvester restaurant. I was so embarrassed. And my symptoms were moving quite rapidly. The tremor was the most significant thing, but other things were happening. My balance was changing. My posture was changing, my gait was changing. I was getting a dry mouth. I had to have a speech therapist because I couldn't swallow properly. I was choking on my food. And there's so many changes, and all of them are all symptomatic of Parkinson's disease. It wasn't always like this.
It was so
absolutely
bad.
Absolutely like that.
And it started to shake, so all his head used to shake.
Yeah.
Do you remember? Yeah. All your head shook.
Inside.
Your arm shook.
My body
inside was shaking.
So I'd got to a stage in my life where I was so broken that if death was the next step, I probably wouldn't have worried too much at that point. Because I just couldn't do it anymore.
He came home that first, it was the half term, and he was so excited to come home. And he came in and he said, "I have met this wonderful girl. She is just the most amazing girl you've ever met. I just don't know what to do, Mum. She is amazing. And she's a pastor's daughter. And I've accepted Jesus as my saviour." And we was like, what?
Wow.
You've done all of that. You've now come home telling us this thing.
It was a shock.
However, TJ was excited, wasn't he?
He
was passionate for the word. So he was reading the Bible. So now we'd have a knock on our door every couple of hours. It was every couple of hours.
Yeah, in the early days.
We were in bed at that time. It was to do with, we couldn't move around very much. You weren't very well.
No.
And we'd given up. I think we were totally depressed. Every couple of hours, he'd knock on the door, come in, and start shouting at us, "Right, this is what has to happen. This is how you have to go now. You have to listen to the Bible. You have to read this." I said to him one day, I said, "Okay, we'll listen. But what you have to do is you have to come down a little bit and calm down, and then we'll listen to what you've got to say." And he did. He did it. Like, he just did it. He was trying to shake us. He was trying
the
to.
The Lord was knocking on our door for a long time.
He was thinking, listen, I've come this way, I've come that way, yeah. and you're not listening. So this is what you're going to listen to. Maybe this is the language, isn't
it? Battle raging,
so we said, okay, let us do it. So he went back to uni just after Christmas, which was January. By February, Auntie Marlene phones us with my cousin Windsor. And they're on the other end of the phone going, right, this is it now. We've prayed for you for all these years. Now it's your decision, make it. He's not letting up. God is not letting up, so we're gonna do it. It was a Sunday morning.
Yeah.
And we'd gone to Costco and we were coming back round the roundabout in Beckenham. And I looked over and there were these people coming out this building and I thought, that's a church? And I said to you, that's the church we're going to go to.
Yeah.
That week we phoned Becky.
Yeah.
We phoned the church, the office, and spoke to Becky. We said, we're disabled. I'm in a wheelchair and Mike's on a stick and he shakes and we've got very big disabilities going on here. And she went, yeah, that's okay, no problem, in her lovely voice at the other end of the phone. And she said, just come, just when are you coming? And we said, we're coming this Sunday. And that was the first week in August.
I went in there with an open mind, a broken mind, but an open one. And I weren't looking to get something. I just knew I had to go and speak to God. I said to the Lord, I'm here. What do I do? I'm here, I'm lost, I'm broken. What do I do? And the healing began from that second. Spirit was first. I wasn't broken anymore.
I remember sitting, they took a chair out and I sat in my wheelchair on the end and the music started and my soul danced. I remember thinking, wow, I wish I could jump up here right now, and I couldn't at that moment. And I wish I could dance, and I wish I could just praise the Lord right now. We accepted Jesus immediately on that day that we came to City Gate, on that first day. We accepted Jesus as our Saviour straight away. It wasn't...
We didn't put our hand up.
We didn't put our hand up.
We'd done it already.
We, in our mind, as the music was playing, and I felt, it was like my spirit had come alive. It was like, wow, something has changed. Something has changed forever right now. I knew in my head there was work to do, but something has changed.
A massive change.
We had, oh gosh, goosebumps. Thank you, Jesus. It had changed. I felt it at that moment. And on the way home, from that service, we phoned Auntie Marlene.
We did.
We phoned her.
I was so excited.
Yeah. And I said, we've just been to church and we've just accepted Jesus as our Savior. We wanted to tell her before we told anybody else.
We did.
And she was so excited. Yeah. She was screaming and,
was.
Wow, this is wonderful. How amazing. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. As we were going through those weeks, I could feel just a burden, like we were getting rid of our burdens. It's almost like we were going along in this car and every day we were just chucking a bad thing out.
Ow.
The depression just lifted.
It just lifted.
It just stopped.
I can't tell you the day the tremor stopped. Because everything's so natural. I still have a very slight one now and then. But it's hardly noticeable. And compared to what it was, it's just incredible. Absolutely incredible. On that one day, that in one day, you could go, I mean, there's no therapy I've ever experienced in my life, and I've had quite a bit, and there's no medication either that I've experienced in my life, where you can spend one session, when you go in there, broken. And come out fixed.
Yeah.
Look. Oh my word.
Isn't it crazy, isn't it?
Incredible.
gosh, I looked old.
Yeah, it was didn't the strain I? Of life.
Oh, look at your face. Oh, bless you.
Wow, look at that.
I just said, Lord, fix me. And I got into the, I remember getting up and walking across and getting into the pool. And I thought, I am going to walk out of here on my own. And as I walked up the stairs, my whole body went into spasm. Complete spasm. Yeah. And I still didn't get despondent. I thought, okay, this is new, this is different.
Yeah.
Whatever you decide to do, God, fix me. Whatever you decide to do, I'll accept.
Yeah.
And we came home, went to bed, and I woke up on that Monday morning, and I woke up. And I woke up, didn't I? I just woke
up. Your
body woke up. My body woke up. I woke up. Yeah. I was like, wow, this is amazing. And got up and walked. No. I've not looked back at the wheelchair since.
No.
Yeah, he healed me, but he healed me, my mental state.
Yeah.
I was so depressed, and depression can make you so ill, can't it?
Yeah.
But God fixed it.
You know, mental health is such a hard thing to deal with when you haven't got the Lord. It's such a difficult thing. But when you have got the Lord, it was never an issue. You know, never an issue. The troubles I used to have in my mind, they're nowhere to be seen. Gone. Some would say, well, you're not fixed to Parkinson's completely yet. But listen, from where I was, it's incredible and amazing. And I'm thankful and grateful every day for what he's done. All these things are possible because of what the Lord did for me and for you.
Yeah. God's not done with that story yet.
Isn't that awesome? Mike and Jill. Pastor Julian told me when I let him know that we asked his permission to share this, he said that he'll never forget it as long as he lives. He helped literally carry Jill into the baptistry. They carried her out of a wheelchair into the baptistry, and then she walked out. But then the next day was completely healed. I was overwhelmed, and I hope you can sense the goodness of God in this. That's like a total overhaul. And I love the way she described it as driving down the road the next couple of days after responding to God and kind of throwing stuff out. She'd go chucking it out the window. It's just an amazing thing to consider. And I want to consider you to consider this as well. The prayers of her aunties were working on their whole family for years and years. Decades. And then it was their son who was 20 years old. It was him that found Jesus, had an encounter with him because of meeting a pastor's daughter. Imagine what happened. And then he came home, and they said from the beginning their communication was loud, so he screamed at them. I thought that really showed it right there. I mean, that's what happens in a lot of families. They just scream at each other. God used their son. And then I want to remind you also, water baptism is also very important to seal what's going on in your heart. And so that process took place. They've only been walking with the Lord less than 2 years, and yet now they're life group leaders in their church. And they have a whole church of people, the whole group of people that are coming to their church, to their home. God is using them greatly in their, you know, probably mid-50s or whatever they are. Just imagine what God can do. What he can do and how your prayers are still working in the world. God's good. He's good all the time. And his goodness is stronger than you think. His goodness is loving kindness. Power, covenant power in action. Would you bow your head and close your eyes right now? Father, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you that we can come boldly before the throne of grace, that we can find your mercy and your loving kindness right now afresh in this place. Lord, I don't know what's going on in people's lives, homes, and hearts, but you do. You know what's going on within each of them, within each of us. And you know our needs, our hopes, our dreams. You know the attacks of the enemy. And your word says that when the enemy comes in, like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against them. Holy Spirit, would you come and flood this place with your overwhelming loving kindness? Flood this place with your mercy, with your grace, and with your power. And go into action on behalf of your kids and those you've been dealing with that may have slipped in today unnoticed. Would you let this be the day? Would you let this be the day where that knocking on their hearts becomes an openness to the Holy Spirit and to the presence and power of Jesus' name? I pray for you today. Maybe you're going through a challenge in your life. I know there are those needing healing in our body. Maybe you're watching from home on our online campus right now. We release God's healing power right now to you. If God can do it for them, he can do it for you. The Bible says he's no respecter of persons. If you need an overhaul, our God can overhaul you. But it's about your willingness to receive. It's about that moment of opportunity where you say, God, I want everything you have, just like Jill did. I want everything you have for me, and I'm going to trust you in this. If you're here today and you're ready to trust him as Lord, as Savior, you can do that before you leave the room. If you're here today, you're ready to trust him as healer, you better find those scriptures. You better know that you know that you know, like you know your name, that he died for you in your place, that by his whip marks borne on his back, you were healed 2,000 years ago legally. You were legally healed. Now you have to enter into that legal covenant right and privilege to say, Jesus, yes, I receive your wholeness in my life. I pray that over you in Jesus' name. And I come into agreement with the word, and I come against every evil assignment, every generational curse, every tendency and every attack trying to knock on your door or the door of your children or your grandchildren. In the name of Jesus, we lay the axe to the root of the family tree right now by the blood of Jesus, and we speak life where there's been struggle. We speak blessing where there has been weakness. We speak strength in Jesus' name. Be blessed and receive him, Jesus, right where you sit, right where you are. Open your heart and say, yes, Lord, I want everything you have for me. I remember something comes up in my spirit when she said, we were tired of the cycles. We just kept going through the same cycle over and over again. My friends, if you're in a cycle of brokenness, that's the enemy. That's not God's best. But you have to purposely get off that cycle, get off that merry-go-round, and ask God to come in with his goodness. Receive that covenant-keeping God in your heart. In Jesus' name, to as many as received him, he gave the power to become sons and daughters of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you give him praise today? Lift up your voice and clap your hands, all you people. Shout to God in the voice of triumph. He's good. Amen. We got a couple things before you go. Really interesting things coming up. I want to invite you to something personally. So one of my good friends, one of our financial advisors for the last 16 years almost, dear friend Joe Monaco out of Virginia Beach, Virginia, he's one of our financial advisors to us personally and the church. And Joe is taking his first three-week vacation he's ever had as a financial planner. He's got a PhD in economics from Columbia University. Mighty man of God, spirit-filled believer. And he's taking his three-week vacation to the villages. So I have convinced Joe to come on his vacation and come and be with us for Saturday morning, April 29th, for an hour and a half, 11 a.m. to 12:30. I'm calling it a cup of Joe, okay? Because it's going to be just coffee and continental breakfast, and you don't have to have coffee. You can have juice. You can have whatever. But it's just going to be an informal gathering, probably in the hub, and we're going to spend just an hour and a half. Joe he's one of the wisest financial minds I've ever met. And he is in the middle of where everybody else is screaming chaos and we're going over the cliff. He's always like, no, no, no. You don't understand what's going on in the behind the scenes of the whole economy. But he does. And he has talked me off the ledge a few times in terms of investments and things. I want to invite you. The only thing we need is we need you to RSVP. And so there is a QR code right over here. Please sign up. It's no cost. It's free. We're not trying to get anything from you. I want to get as many of you that can. And that means young people. Let me just tell you a little secret here, okay? So I turned 62 the other day, all right, on Thursday. I know you knew it was my birthday. 62. 62 is one of those weird birthdays where nothing happens. But it was weird for me because when I first started in my mid to late 30s, I went and opened a retirement account. And they said, well, you can do a Roth IRA. I said, what's that? They said, well, it's a tax deferred thing. You can start now with just a little bit and you can't touch it till you're 62. And I was like, well, that's eternity away. That's, yeah, I mean, sure. Well, now I'm 62. I still don't want to touch it because now it's down a lot from the economy. But I'm just telling you that sometimes you need to just start when you're younger, and the earlier you start thinking about stuff, the less you have to worry about it. I started putting away, I think it was $100 a month, back in my 30s. And it grew, exponentially. And then Joe got a hold of it 16 years ago, and he really helped build that thing up. It's not a huge thing, but it's a blessing, and it's there. Come and hear wisdom. I don't want to, I've gone too long about Joe, but you'll love Joe. He's great. And please let us know if you're coming, okay? This week, by the way, ushers, if you would get up, we need tithes and offerings. We're going to get envelopes out there. If you need an envelope or an iGave card, you know who you are. I want to tell you, this past week, we were able to help Pastor Valery Kuzmich again in Ukraine. He let us know right before Easter that a place in Poland wanted to donate to them a new van because they've worn out two vans now driving all over Ukraine delivering food to people in need and protection of those people that were displaced. So we were able to get this van. He needed like $5,000 to be able to get through all the tariffs and all the stuff. I don't know why they're charging tariffs in Europe for people in Ukraine. But whatever, we were able to sow a big seed already last week. Thank you for your giving, because your giving last week helped us to help Pastor Valery Kuzmich right on the front line of the war zone in Kharkiv, Ukraine. And he said this time when he texted me back, he said he got the money and thanked us for it. He said, I'm looking forward to the day as soon as we have the complete victory where you're going to come to see me in eastern Ukraine in Kharkiv and be with me. And I said, yes, I'll be there whenever God says it's the victory, you know. And I'm thankful for that. So I'm going to go see him, a good dear friend of mine. Also, we told you a couple of months ago that we were contacted by the Marion County Fire Department by some Christian leaders there saying that there was a suicide issue with several firefighters. And it was an epidemic. There were two or three within a few weeks back in January, February. They were praying for solutions. We sent Pastor Tristan to represent us at a meeting of the community with pastors and firefighter leaders. We are able, thanks to you, we were able to sow a big seed last week toward a solution. They're hiring a new chaplain, and we were able to help provide the salary for the new chaplain because of what you did last week. So give yourself a hand. I mean, that's awesome. We're able to help make a difference and show God's loving kindness. Amen. God is doing great stuff. God is good, and he wants to be good to you, but he wants to be good through you. You're blessed. That's the covenant, to be a blessing. You're blessed to be a blessing. Let's pray one more time. Father, thank you for the opportunity we have. We pray and send mighty angels of God to help Pastor Valeri and his wife and daughter and their whole church there in Kharkiv. Let more and more people continue to respond and to know you, Jesus. Surround them with your protection and let that enemy be defeated in that nation, and let that nation show the glory of God as the churches rise up in freedom afresh. And we thank you, Lord. We arrest that spirit of suicide and depression from our firefighters, our police officers, our sheriff's department. We take authority over that spirit of violence and death in our community, and we release you, your angels and your power, Holy Spirit, to go make a difference. Thank you for raising up the right chaplain now in that program that actually carries a spirit of faith and power to make a difference in our community. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for your generosity. We appreciate you.
All right, we've got a few announcements for you. Really, to go along with what Pastor Richard was just saying, liftoff is tonight for those that are really looking for that whole life change and really where the beginning is. Liftoff is really the on-ramp, if you will, of relationship with God, but also relationship with this church and getting involved in this area. So that's going to be taking place today at 5 o'clock. We have this registration as well here too, if you want to register for that. Again, if you're newer to Now Church and you're not involved yet, you want to become a member, this is that track as well too. So we want to make sure that you were there. It's going to be so good. About an hour or so and then we're done. Also, Now Youth is going to be meeting tonight for Chocolate Wars at 6 p.m. here as well too. So they're going to have some good time, and maybe if you go to Liftoff, we can steal some of their chocolate. I don't know. Let's see what happens. Anyway, and then MVP, this is our new relaunch of men's ministry, Men of Vision and Purpose. We're going to be launching this or relaunching this next Sunday at 5 o'clock. We're going to be meeting at Paisano's over by Grand Oaks Shopping Center. What this is all about, we want to really just be able to cast a vision for what this is going to be. So all men, you are invited. We're going to be able to get involved and get information to you. If you were a part of Men Versus Food previously, you're going to be hearing from me this week. But if you haven't heard from me there, make sure you come and talk to me. We want to make sure that you're in that list, and we can text you and let you know the details. But it's 5 o'clock, and we're going to be gathering together for food and vision. It's going to be great. And then also, see, we have MVP, and we also have GNO, Girls Night Out. We're going to be getting together, Girls Night Out, not we, they will be getting together, Girls Night Out, and they're going to have a very fun time. So it's going to be awesome. They have a QR code as well here to register, because we want to make sure that they know who is coming. That's going to be Thursday 27th at 7 p.m. Register and pay right here for the details. You'll get all the details there when you use this registration code. All right? Go ahead and stand up. We love you guys. We will see you. If you are newer, we'll hopefully see you tonight at Liftoff.
Thanks for joining us at Now Church. For the latest updates, visit us at nowchurch.com, including live or on-demand video, event registration, online giving, and much more. And don't forget to follow Now Church on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag #NowChurch. Thank you.